10-minute presentation, and then any questions you have between myself, Michael, and Robin will be here as long as the questions keep rolling in. I don't know how many people here are familiar with the Ottadian gas site. Anyone who's lived in Kingston for many years, I'm sure, is aware of it, but I see some folks here that don't look that old. Some folks may not have experienced the Ottadian gas site, Kingston Steel Drum Site, during the period 1950 to 1980. That's when the operation was pretty much in full swing. And what they did was they took in steel drums that had residual chemicals in it from a variety of sources. And they basically dumped whatever contents were remaining in the drums in this area of the site primarily. This is Route 125, Country Pond Marsh and Country Pond, which doesn't show here. But from 1950 to 1980, that was the nature of the operation, was taking in steel drums. Anyone who drove by this site during that period, 1950, 60, 70, would have seen stacks of drums all over the place. The operation stopped around 1980, and it was placed on EPA's national priority list, designated a Superfund site in 1983. In the 1980s and 1990s, a lot of cleanup took place at the site. All the drums were removed, the building that was on the site was removed, and tons of soil from this area was excavated. The lagoons and the dry wells were excavated. A couple of acres of wetland were excavated. So all the drums, the building, and tons of soil and sediment were removed from the site. And around 2008, we did some additional groundwater remediation in this area and that area of the site. We injected the chemical oxidant into the site to destroy the remaining source areas that were on the site. And for 3 years, 2008, 2009, 2010, we did injections of chemical oxidant out at the site. We're here today to talk about PFAS contamination. PFAS stands for per- and polyfluoroalkyl substances. It's a substance that's been used in a wide range of products that we've used every day of our lives. PFAS shed water, they shed grease, they're low friction, they're used to make Teflon. All of our old Teflon-coated frying pans had PFAS in them. Our Gore-Tex clothing has PFAS in it, our dental floss has PFAS in it. We get PFAS from a wide range of readily available consumer products. So PFAS is one of these widespread contaminants that's hard not to detect it just about anywhere nowadays. It's a relatively new contaminant. It's an emerging contaminant. I didn't hear about the word PFAS until, I think, 2016. So at all of our sites in New Hampshire anyways, all of our Superfund sites, we have been looking for PFAS. And we sampled for the first time for PFAS at the Ottadian gas site in fall of 2018, and we were just looking at the groundwater. Our initial phase of investigation, we wanted to look within the center of the site where historic operations took place. We wanted to look up gradient of the site, where we wouldn't expect to find any PFAS. And we looked down gradient of the site as well, where we would expect to detect a little bit of PFAS that's migrating from the site. So we did that in 2018. We got a final report in late winter of 2019. And this figure, which only the folks in the front row can really highest concentration that we found is in this area of the site, which I guess is really no surprise. That's, I mean, there was an old dry well at one time in this area of the site, and this is the area of the site where the highest concentrations of all the contaminants has typically been found. So we did find PFAS in this area as high as around 5.6 parts per billion, or 5,600 parts per trillion. So those levels were high enough for us to expand our investigation. So we went out just in May, the last couple of weeks of May, we were doing some sampling, additional sampling out at the site. I'll just describe the sampling that we did. The next chart shows the results for surface water, which is good news, by the way. I don't want to leave everyone in suspense. The results that we found in surface water were very low, so well below any health-based level that's been developed. So that's the bottom line. This is the initial round of groundwater sampling. You call it an east-west delineation of the groundwater. We needed to expand it in this direction because we want to find the edge of the PFAS plume. So we sampled additional wells to the south, we sampled additional wells to the north, and we sampled a number of private drinking water wells within 1,000 feet, plus or minus, of the site as well. We don't have those results yet. We're waiting for those results. Those results should be available next week, and we'll share those results with your town government, Kingston, Newton, and I can get Greg a copy of the results as well, as soon as they're available. But we did collect surface water samples, and we had those done at the EPA lab in Chelmsford. So I was able to call in a few favors and get those results pretty quick. Before I talk about the results, let me talk about the calculation that we did to develop a health-based allowable level. We made some assumptions on how frequently Country Pond is used for wading and swimming. I expect to get some feedback from you here today saying, no, that's too low, we use it more than that, or yeah, that sounds about right. I think no matter which, even if we multiply the use we assume by a factor of 10, we're still below levels that would be of any concern. The levels are that low. So what we did for surface water is we went as far upstream in Southbrook as we possibly could, and Northbrook as well. And we sampled the two culverts that flow underneath 125 for now Northbrook and Southbrook. We sampled at two locations within Country Pond where Southbrook and Northbrook have merged together. We sampled at the outlet of, we'll call that Northbrook, to Country Pond. We sampled at the beach area here, and we sampled at the Boy Scouts beach area down there. The highest concentrations, let me give you the health-based number first. The health-based number that was developed is 7.6 parts per billion, or 7,600 parts per trillion. That's equates to a hazard index of 1. That's what they call it in the risk assessment world. Anything equal or less than 1 isn't likely to cause any health effects. So that's the number that we got from our risk assessors. And you know, for our purposes, for determining whether or not we need to do some additional studies, we typically divide that health-based number by 10. And if we exceed that, then we may feel like we still need to do more investigation to make sure we completely understand the problem. So the health-based number is 7,600, and that level at which we might decide to do more investigation, which we call a screening level, is 760. So the maximum concentrations we found out here in far as we could get, South Brook was 25. North Brook, it's about 20. Right at the culvert of North Brook, flowing underneath 125, it was about 170. It was very low at South Brook, the culvert flowing underneath the 125, it was 7.3. In this area of the wetland, it was around 200. This point here, it was around 100. The outlet at Country Pond was around 130. The beach area, it's less than 30. And at the Boy Scout camp, it's even lower. It's it's about 10 to 15 parts per trillion. So the health base number, which was based on using Country Pond for 120 days straight for 1 hour a day, that number is 7,600. So even if you were to say, my kids are out there, maybe not swimming, but they're at least wading in the area, walking along the beach, whatever, for 10 hours a day for 120 days, the allowable level would be 760. So no matter which exposure scenario you may think is appropriate out there, we're always going to be well below what we've developed for a safe lifetime exposure level. So it's good news. It's good news. We're waiting for the private drinking water well sample results to come back. I don't know if anyone in here has had their well sampled, but that's for us, that's the higher level of concern, because you don't have any choice but to drink your water. You can choose whether or not you're going to swim in Country Pond, but you have to drink your water. So that's it. Really don't have much else to present in the way of PFAS data today. So it's all question, and hopefully we have good answers at this point.
So this is a snapshot of a certain day and time.
Yeah.
What about going forward? What are the plans?
Well, we're well below even our screening levels, those levels at which we might decide we should do additional investigation. However, I think this is a unique situation. I personally think that we should go out there at another time and collect some additional surface water samples. And I am talking with my management to try to secure resources to make that all happen. But I think that, this has been a very rainy spring. Water levels are pretty high, groundwater levels are pretty high. So I think we have a good sample for that sort of season. I think a dry season. I'd like to know what's going on when it's not drought, but it hasn't rained in a while, but there's less dilution going on. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to collect a sample during an event like that. This may be a summer where it's just raining like we've had the last couple of months, I don't know. But if we can get a typical summer where it's not incredibly wet, late summer, typically a little bit drier, I believe, we'd like to try to collect some additional samples around that time of year.
So the safety level that the EPA has established is 7.6 parts per trillion?
Billion. 7,600 parts per trillion.
Okay, and at the Boy Scout camp it was 10 to?
Yeah, there's we sampled at different water depths, but we're not quite sure how PFAS might it could be higher at the surface than down deep. We didn't actually find any difference, but right at the surface it was about 10. 2.5 feet depth, it was 17, 18, it was 21. And then at 4.5 feet, it was about 10.
So the 7.6, is that thousands?
These
Versus?
These are parts per trillion.
Per trillion, okay.
These are, everything, every number on this board is a part per trillion number. And the highest we're finding, which is in, where Northbrook crosses Route 125, was around 200 parts per trillion.
So how is that not higher than the 7.6?
Where you?
7,600.
That's per billion.
7.6 parts per billion.
Per billion, and this is per trillion?
This is per trillion.
Okay.
What is the drinking water health standard?
EPA's health advisory is 70 parts per trillion. That's a lifetime of drinking water with PFAS in it. 70 parts per trillion. The state has different numbers that, for one of the PFAS compounds, I think it's 40 parts per trillion, but.
It's 70 right now.
It's still 70? But they're thinking about changing it, they're in the process of doing that. So, you know, I didn't want to kind of raise this point because no one should be drinking Country Pond water, but but the levels that we got here at this beach and at the Boy Scouts beach is lower than what we would allow to drink for your whole life.
So is there any filtration systems for your home that will eliminate
carbon? Carbon works very well for PFAS.
Is this contamination assumed to come from the site, or can it come from other sources?
Well, there's a lot we don't know about PFAS,
right,
and what you'd find just about anywhere in any surface water body in the whole country. Now we're just beginning to understand what background concentrations might be. But, you know, we found PFAS at the site, so
yeah.
It'd be hard to convince myself, or for me to convince anyone, that what we're finding in Country Pond isn't at least to some degree related to the site. I'm not sure there is some background contribution as well, but.
Two questions.
Yeah.
Why would they let people dump barrels of chemicals for 30 years?
Yeah, there was no EPA until 1970.
They did it everywhere. Well, what can we do as wake owners to make Country Pond better? I mean, is there anything we can do to fight this PFAS?
Well, you know, we're not seeing that PFAS is a problem in Country Pond based on the data that we have right now. And some of your other problems, you know, nitrates and phosphates and things like that are, I think, want to tell you what you should be concerned most about, but to me, those are bigger environmental issues.
Do you expect changes year to year in the concentrations in the area that you find PFAS in?
The site's been here a long time, and you know, we didn't sample for PFAS, you know, prior to cleaning up the site because no one knew about PFAS. We excavated a lot of soil and sediment, removed a lot of drums, so I'm sure some of what we removed contained, you know, probably the majority of the mass of PFAS. What's left is what seeps into the groundwater.
What depth are those wells tested at?
They're various. Some of them are bedrock wells, some of them are overburden wells, some of them are shallow, some of them are collected right at the interface between bedrock and overburden groundwater, and there are some that are true bedrock wells. And now we're waiting for the results from the private drinking water wells, which I'm sure some of those are bedrock. I would assume the majority of them are, but I don't know. Some of them could be overburden wells. Lots of questions. Good.
I have two questions. The Region 1 screening levels that you talk about, I'm Mindy Mesmer, by the way, are much, much higher than the screening levels for Barry's Brook, which isn't used for swimming as much. It was in the range of 760 for the most conservative and around 1,000 for the more lesser conservative. It's not used for swimming as much as Country Pond. The EPA screening levels listed for peas so far are around 1,000 as well. So I just want to know how you came up with so much higher Region 1 screening levels for this particular, knowing that this is used for swimming?
Screening levels are